when I was a kid growing up, we had snow like it seemed like forever. Snowshoeing was a big part, going sleigh riding, hunting in the wintertime, wearing snowshoes, fishing on the ice. Cindy Bay hasn't froze over for a couple of years now. As a kid, I remember that bay usually froze over in February. It hasn't frozen at all this year. There's been ice along the shorelines. Some of the little inner harbors and that, maybe they have a little bit of ice on them, but the bay itself hasn't frozen over.
When we look at where sugar maples will be comfortable with the impacts of climate change in maybe 2070, 2080, they'd have to go up to the Hudson Bay coast. They'd go over to Quebec, to the eastern side of James Bay, rather than down to southern Ontario and the Niagara Peninsula. That's what the maps for the 2050s, 2070s, end of the century look like.
My name is Nathan Keeshig. I work with the Chippewas and Awash First Nation. I manage the Cape Croker Park and our maple syrup enterprise, Ziibaakdakaan Maple. And today we're here to talk about climate change and maple syrup production.
I'm David Pearson. I'm a retired professor from Laurentian University. I came here as a geologist. I took 6 years leave to be the project director for Science North, and that led me to become interested in climate change.
I really loved working in parks. I always thought that that's where I belonged. And it was a good opportunity for me to return back to my home and try to make some sense out of what was happening here and what could I bring to make this band operation a success. One of the biggest thrills I get is that I walked every inch of this bush where we put trees, and you see the same trees year after year. There's a quick way of testing to see what the diameter of the tree is, for example. That if you can hug a tree and your fingers don't touch, that's probably 18 inches. And that's what I enjoy doing. I get out and measuring trees and hugging trees just to see that everything is still there.
The tree might look inactive at the moment. It may look as though it's doing nothing. But in fact, what's happening right up at the tips of the branches is that there's some evaporation taking place. And there's also, during the warmth of warm days, there's also some melting taking place, melting of ice in some of the cells, and that is reducing the compression, is allowing the sugar to move through the outside part of the tree. This is a cross-section, not of a sugar maple, but of a silver maple, and it's coming down the tree, and it's coming out of the hole that you see that's been drilled there. Sugar, water, sap, that store that's beneath my feet in the roots is what the tree will use and will draw up to the leaves during the next summer. Because as the leaves are growing and manufacturing sucrose, manufacturing sugar, they're also, water is also evaporating from the surface of the leaves. The tree is transpiring. The transpiration of the tree is keeping the leaves cool. And not only is it keeping the leaves cool, it's cooling this yard. It's cooling the house. It's cooling the environment around it. So it's acting like an air conditioner.
I remember the first year that we were putting taps up, there was so much snow out there that we were hanging our taps, not realizing how much snow there was. So when it come time to pull the taps out, some of the taps were like 7-8 feet above us after the snow had gone. And we ever had these long extractor thing for pulling the taps out, and we still had to jump up in some places to reach up and pull the taps out. So the last couple of years, we haven't had to wear snowshoes at all when we're out tapping. This year, I was looking at the temperatures going up, and then it's been such an unusual Christmas time. There was no snow, the grounds are bare. You could actually see, when I was looking across the bay, that some of the trees, in particular the aspen, looked like they were ready to start flushing in the 1st of January. Like you see the tops of the trees, just there's a different shade to the buds are starting to push. And I could see that from my place and say, oh my God, what's going on here? And geez, it was so surprising that for that time of year, and it was just getting above zero, that as soon as I put the tap in, the sap was there immediately. So we looked at the long range forecast and said, we're going to be getting almost a week of this weather, so we should try and make the most of it. So we changed plans right away and we started tapping. That was the second week in February that we were tapping.
A tree of this size would draw about 200 liters of water a day. And a family bathtub is about 300 liters. So it's a lot of water. A big oak would draw twice that, 400, maybe even 500 liters a day. But what it tells you is how critical the moisture is in the soil for every tree, including the sugar maple.
We've seen severe weather during the summertime, and the storms seem to be more violent. There's been little F0 tornadoes that have been so close to the community. And I myself have observed more water spouts than, as a kid, I never saw water spouts. I think as a sugar maker or as somebody that depends on that as a livelihood, you just have to be ready to adapt yourself to whatever the conditions change. Maybe you have to start your harvesting early. I've heard people talking about maybe giving the trees a rest and not harvesting at all.
If your livelihood depends on the output of your maple sugar trees, then you need to do two things. You need to make sure that the trees are not too close to each other, because if they are too close to each other, their roots will overlap and they'll be competing for water. You don't want competition. The other thing that you need to do is to make sure that they're getting the water they need. Water is really, really critical in summer for not just trees, every plant, garden flowers and whatever it might be. And when the ground is bare, and let's say we're in the middle of June and the average temperature is usually 20 degrees on the soil, and the average temperature on the next week is 21 degrees, then 15% more water will evaporate from that soil surface than when the temperature was 20 degrees. The other aspect of water in summer is that for every degree increase in air temperature, the air can hold 7% more water. Water molecule stays in the air 9 days, which means that that extra 7% water is going to rain out somewhere. And if the increase in air temperature is 2 degrees or 3 degrees or 4 degrees, then all the more water can be held by the atmosphere. And what that's beginning to result in is extreme rainfall, very heavy rain. One of the consequences of extreme rainfall is erosion. That can be very severe on ecosystems of all kinds, but also for sugar maple trees, because they need to be able to draw their nutrients from the soil. And if they lose that soil, then that's not good for their long-term health. The other part of the water source for a sugar maple tree, and for any tree actually, is the precipitation that falls in the winter. And if we've got enough snow, it can be a source of water for the spring growth for the tree and the beginning of the summer as well. So it's not just what falls as rainfall, it's what fell during the winter and melts and feeds the soil water. That's what you want. You want a long, slow melt, not a sudden one, because if you get a sudden melt, then the ground may still be frozen and the water runs off straight into a lake, straight into a creek. That's no good for maple trees.
I had come across a map before that identified the location as being Ziibaakdakaan. And I didn't know what that meant until I asked somebody that could speak Ojibwe. And they just said that was a sugar bush. And I guess historically that has always been the sugar bush for our people. Our people had been here for forever, or for time immemorial. I remember as a kid that my grandfather would make maple syrup up in that area. The first tap ceremony was something I thought was going to be, that was very important for us to do. Our people had always gave thanks, or would give thanks, or lay down tobacco, hoping that we're going to do our harvesting in a good way. We're hoping for the best harvest that we can get. So it brings people from the community to come and share their experience as well, and have a little bit of a meal. And there's some storytelling, and some singing and some dancing. And some people find it very emotional. I had people in the community come up to me and he says, that maple syrup operation has really put us on the map. They're so proud of that. So our maple syrup has literally gone all over the world so far. There are so many opportunities here. So many people in southwestern Ontario, southern Ontario, that aren't very far away from here anymore. Like, the highways and everything have improved. If we have success with this, then we can employ more people. We can, I'm hoping, have sustainable employment opportunities for the people of Chippewas and Awash. The Cape Croker Park is pretty much self-sustaining now with this operation as well. I think it's important to know that the wages for the people that are working here now have gone up steadily over the last few years. People can look at having a place that they can make a career of. Like, you don't have to leave home to make yourself a living wage anymore. There's opportunities here.
In the collaborations that I've been lucky enough to become involved in with remote First Nations, fly-in First Nations that depend on ice roads in the winter, I've learned that what one needs to do in order to be able to talk about the ways that those climate change impacts they're feeling can be, the risks can be lowered, that they can adapt to those changes. One needs to take Western science, my knowledge from my university and reading books and so forth, and the observations of First Nations, what they've seen happening, what elders can talk about, and the changes they've seen, to put those two knowledges together.
My grandfather used barrels and iron kettles. We have a high-pressure vacuum pump that we can start drawing in from all over the forest and bring that to one central point, and that's where our sugar house is. We use reverse osmosis, which is like a water desalinization plant. We have a 1,135-gallon storage tank for that, and we set that upstairs along with our concentrate. We use a wood-fired evaporator. It's capable of boiling off like 200 gallons an hour. The vacuum situation, the vacuum pump, very important for us. We've got so many lines that are out, and everything is numbered, and when we're out putting the lines in place, one of the salesmen come up with me and he says, oh, did you know there's an app you can get for your operation where you can monitor your vacuum just by using your phone. So I went out and we bought the system, and we put it, I think we have 9 sensors out, and we can tell by looking on our app what the vacuum pressure is there, as well as the temperature and the battery. So it helps us identify where our leaks are, where we have our trouble spots, to maximize our harvest as well. And very fun to be able to show off a little bit. We're still learning as we go along.